Wow. I love worshiping on Sunday morning with you all. It is, wow, what a privilege. What a privilege. Well, we're continuing in our series, Unsung, Everyday People, Uncommon Faith. And I just have to say this. I know that this is going to come as a shock to some people who haven't been thinking about it, but school is starting soon. It's coming fast for a lot of people. I heard some boos and some ahs, and I know the students are in anguish, and the parents are kind of rejoicing a little bit, right? It's back to school, and that means the end of summer, but I love summer. Maybe you're like me. I love summer. It's refreshing, isn't it? Isn't it refreshing? Like going on vacations with your family or spending time at the beach or at the pool or outside with friends grilling some delicious meats and sitting by the fire at night with some s'mores. I mean, it's nice, isn't it? It's nice to be refreshed. So I did a little thought study of the most refreshing things that happened during the summer. And so just go with me. Imagine that this is a sweltering hot day. Maybe a couple days ago when it was like 99 degrees. Just think of that day and then think of how refreshing these things would be. Are you ready? A cold glass of iced tea on a hot afternoon. The feeling of when your feet hit the water of the lake at the first time, right? That surge of refreshment. Watching the sunset after a long day. Driving with the top down in your car or in your friend's car if you don't have that feature like me, right? The spray of the water off of the boat as you're driving on the lake. The perfect drizzle of rain on a hot summer's day. This is my personal favorite, ready? The cold side of the pillow on a hot summer's night. Amen? Woo! Or how about when it's a hot day out and you first walk into the coolness of air conditioning? Your whole body is just refreshed. I'm feeling refreshed just talking about these things. These are things that are definitely refreshing, right? They're definitely refreshing. The problem is that they are temporary. These things refresh you one time and just for a little bit, and then it's over. And it's back to chasing the next refreshing thing. Now, wouldn't it be amazing if there was something that could refresh you not only for a moment, but that could refresh you forever? Wouldn't that be amazing? Let's talk about that this morning. We're going to be in the Gospel of John in chapter 4. And we're going to start in verse 7, and we're going to go till verse 42. So I hope you brought your spiritual seatbelts because we are driving fast and we are driving far. We're going through a little bit today, and so hope you're ready. The title of today's message is Refreshed by Living Water. And we're going to be taking a look at a pretty familiar passage, one that many of you probably already know. Maybe you know it by heart. Maybe you've heard it a ton of times when you were growing up in Sunday school and through Bible studies. We're going to be taking a look at a woman in Scripture this morning who was out just looking to get that temporary refreshing of some well water. But what happened is she met a person who offered her something that will refresh her for the rest of eternity. And she learned, and we are going to learn today, this powerful truth, that only the power and presence of Jesus can refresh the deepest longings of our soul. Only the power and presence of Jesus can refresh the deepest longings of our soul. And so as you're turning to John chapter 4, verse 7, I'm going to give us some context until verse 7. So the Pharisees had just learned that more people were being baptized and discipled by Jesus than by John the Baptist. Now, this was a big problem for the Pharisees. They didn't like this. And so to avoid confrontation with the Pharisees, Jesus left Jerusalem and he traveled through Samaria to go back to Galilee. Now, he wanted to avoid the confrontation because it wasn't time to confront the Pharisees yet. This is the beginning of Jesus' ministry, and so there is much ministry that is left to be done. There's so much more that needs to be done, and so it wasn't time to confront the Pharisees just yet. He's going to do that a little bit later, but not just now. And so he takes this route through Samaria to Galilee. Now, there are three routes from Jerusalem to Galilee. Two of those routes go around Samaria. They bypass Samaria altogether. And these two routes are the routes that devout Jews would take. They would bypass Samaria altogether. And we'll learn more about why they do that pretty soon here. But Jesus decides to go right through Samaria, a pretty unconventional route. Now, the reason that Jesus would travel through Samaria, I believe, is because of the sovereign appointment that he has with this woman at this well. But also, it's the shortest route from Jerusalem to Galilee. So he arrives, he goes on this journey, he arrives at this town called Sychar. And he's tired from his journey, he's weary, they're traveling for about a day and a half, and he arrives at this town, and he's tired, and he takes a break at a well, Jacob's well to be specific. And the time is about noon, the sixth hour as the Bible says. And this is where we meet our unsung hero. Look at verse 7 with me, chapter 4, verse 7. A woman from Samaria came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria?" For the Jews had no dealings with Samaritans. Now, there's a lot of historical and ethnic and social things going on here. First, the history of the Jews and the Samaritans is a pretty troubled one. It's a pretty strained relationship. You see, the Samaritans were actually originally Jews. And they were left behind in this event called the Assyrian deportation. Then the Assyrians, they took people, after that event, they took these people and they brought people groups from all around to relocate into the land of Samaria. And then the different people groups, the Gentiles, started to intermarry with the Jewish people of Samaria. And this created a kind of half-breed view that the Jewish people have of the Samaritans. They were viewed as half-breed. They were viewed as lesser. They were viewed as not pure-blood Jews. They were viewed as unclean. Not a great start for their relationship. But then the Samaritans built a temple on a mountain outside of Jerusalem. This is a big no-no, all right? This is a big no-no. And the Jewish people then, under an aggressive leader, went and destroyed that temple of worship. Still not great. Then the Samaritans, they so highly viewed the Pentateuch, which is the first five books of the Bible. They viewed those five books so highly that they practically ignored all the rest of the Old Testament. And so naturally, this infuriated the Jewish people. So the Jewish people viewed these Samaritans as lesser, as unclean. So not a great relationship, right? Not great. And that's not the only thing that's at play right here. But the next thing is that Jewish men seldom talked to women in public. It could be seen as flirting. They were a very prim and proper culture. And especially, I learned this week, especially at a well. Okay, Isaac and Jacob's prospective wives were actually met at a well, and that created this precedent in Jewish culture that unless one is looking for a mate, one should avoid speaking to women in public, especially at wells, which were known as places where men could go and pick up women. So the ancient time well was the modern day bar, right? Fun facts from the Bible, there we go. That's not the only thing that is at play in this story. Third, we have this woman who came out alone, and she came out at noon. Now this is highly unusual because the women in this day, they would go in a group. They would gather water together as a group of people. And they would either do that early in the morning at sunrise, or they would do it at the end of the day, at dusk, at sunset, to avoid the fierce heat of the middle of the day. So they would come out in groups. This woman was alone. And so although we don't know this for absolute certain, it doesn't spell it out in the text for us, I think that we can make the observation that because this woman is coming out at noon, alone, I think we can make the observation that this woman was possibly looked down upon by her community, a little bit of an outcast for the things that she had done and had a low reputation in her town. And I think that that'll become a little bit more apparent as we jump into the passage a little bit more. So Jesus is crossing a lot of historical and ethnic and social boundaries right now, just talking to this Samaritan woman. And this goes to show us a very important truth about Jesus Christ. And if you're taking notes, write this down. No matter who you are, no matter what you've done, no matter where you're from or where you're at, Jesus Christ wants to have an encounter with you. No matter who you are, no matter where you're from, no matter what you've done, no matter where you're at, Jesus wants to have an encounter with you. He wants to have an encounter with you. This woman, this so unlikely of a place at a well, this Samaritan woman crossing all of these boundaries to have an encounter with her. Then look at verse 10. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." Here it is. This is the why. This is why Jesus is crossing these boundaries. This is why Jesus is going straight at this, not caring about the historical feud that's going on between the Jews and the Samaritans. Jesus is evangelizing. He's evangelizing. And he uses this physical thirst and water as an illustration to this woman and completely flips the conversation. Do you see it in the text? He completely flips it. He starts off by asking for a drink of water. He's the one who's thirsty. And then he flips it. I love this. I love how he flips it. He turns the tables and says, no. Wait. You're the thirsty one, and I'm the source of water. You're the thirsty one, and I'm the source of water. I love that. He blows right past the social boundaries, right past the historical feud, right past morality, right past ignorance to bring this woman the gift of God, the living water. Here's the first thing that we're gonna see in this passage is my source of refreshment is Jesus. My source of refreshment is Jesus. This woman thought she was coming out to get that refreshing well water, but in fact was meeting the source of refreshment for her soul that day. And so when Jesus says, if you knew the gift of God, and he talks about living water, what is he saying there? What is he talking about? That's the refreshment of our soul. The refreshment of our soul. It's salvation, and it's everything that comes with salvation. Mercy, grace, forgiveness, justification, sanctification, salvation, and everything that comes with it. The living water flowing and flowing and forever flowing and flowing and flowing. Jesus is the source of our refreshment. He's the source of our soul's eternal refreshment. The verse goes on in verse 11. It says, the woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep." It was about 100 feet deep. "Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come down here to draw water." She is missing it. She's missing it. She doesn't understand that the conversation has just shifted. It shifted from the physical to the spiritual. She's still thinking about the water in the well. That water that has been flowing since the time of Jacob. She's thinking, listen, weird Jewish guy. You've got a better source of water than this well, the one that Jacob built and has been here for hundreds of years and has been flowing those hundreds of years, and you're gonna get me this living water? You don't even have anything to draw the water with. And Jesus is like, yes. He's like, yes. And he uses this powerful craving for water that we as humans have when we're thirsty, and he uses it as a metaphor for spiritual desire. This water that you crave and you think is amazing, it'll just leave you thirsty again. But the water that I offer, the living water, salvation, grace, mercy, forgiveness, justification, will never leave you thirsty again. It will refresh you completely and completely satisfy your soul. I've been watching a little bit of, do you guys know who Bear Grylls is? He's like the Man vs. Wild guy. He like gets into these crazy situations and then like finds a way to survive and get out. You know, I watch it because, you know, it's important information to have. You know, what if I get dropped in the Amazon? You know, I gotta know. I gotta have the tools to get myself out, right? And so I watch Bear and he tells me. And so I was watching this episode and I thought it was really interesting because I learned something brand spanking new and I didn't know this, and it's actually quite dangerous, I would say, to not know this. But there's two different types of water. When you're kind of alone and you're trying to survive, there's two types of water. There's stagnant water and then there's flowing water. Stagnant water is water that's not moving, and in that stagnant water, there grows disgusting bacteria, and all sorts of things get dropped into it, and it is gross, right? And if you drink that water, and you're trying to survive in the wilderness, you're going to get sick, you are going to develop some sort of crazy disease. Like, it's not good. You don't drink that water. And so if you come across a stagnant pool of water, you don't drink it, because if you do, you'll most likely die. And so when you see that, you have to continue searching. You have to go and find the flowing water, really the source of the water, something that's flowing, either the source from a lake that's running through a river or a spring that is bubbling up. You have to find that type of water, because there's no bacteria in that water. It's not going to harm you. I think that's a great picture of what this is here. The stagnant water is the things that we try to go for in our lives to seek refreshment in the physical. It's water, right? I'm going for it. I just need to be refreshed. I need to be refreshed right now. I don't care about the consequences later. I'm just going after this thing. But the truth is that stagnant water leaves you sick. It leaves you wanting. But the flowing water, the source, that satisfies. That doesn't make you sick. It keeps you healthy. It keeps you going. And that is the source. Jesus is the source of our refreshment. He is the very source of our refreshment. And the refreshment that Jesus offers as well, it will do much more than alleviate the physical thirst that we have, but it will refresh your soul completely. So what is being refreshed by Jesus? Who can do that? How do we do? How, where, why, who? I wrote down a couple of things, and I think that this is important to note. Anyone can be refreshed by Jesus. Anyone. This woman at the well, this Samaritan woman, the most unlikely person to have a conversation, this moment, this encounter with a Jewish man. Anyone can have a time of refreshment with Jesus Christ. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what you've done. This woman is living proof that anyone can be refreshed by Jesus Christ. And so if you came in this morning and you thought, there's no way that I can be refreshed by Jesus, yes, you can. You absolutely can. But it doesn't just stop there. It can happen at any time. This was an unlikely time. At noon, at a well, in the middle of really nowhere. This well was well outside the city limits. This could happen at any time. And so maybe for you, the time is now to come and be refreshed by Jesus Christ, by his grace and forgiveness and mercy towards you. Not only can it be anyone or any time, it can be anywhere. Look at how unlikely of a place that this woman has an encounter with Jesus Christ. It's at a well. I mean, that's like encountering Jesus Christ at the gas station. Can you imagine filling up your gas tank and just minding your own business, and all of a sudden, the Savior of the world just starts talking to you? It can happen anywhere. Not just here in church, not just in your prayer groups, not just in your small groups. It can happen anywhere. Jesus can refresh you. So Jesus is the source of my refreshment. And my awareness of my sin is the start. That's the second thing that we're going to see here. My awareness of sin is the start. Look at verse 16 with me. And Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come here." And the woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband,' for you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. So what you said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet." This is a pretty sudden change in the conversation, right? They went from talking about water and the well, and now all of a sudden it's like, boom, straight into like failed relationships. That's a pretty jarring like switch. But this is Jesus evangelizing. Jesus is evangelizing. He shifts the conversation towards her deepest need. Since this woman doesn't get at all the spiritual gifts of grace that Jesus is offering her, he sees it as important to make this shift to her greatest need and guide her into realizing her need and that he has the solution for it. Jesus confronts her sin right then and there. This is the deepest need that she has. This is the deepest need that we all have. This is the deepest need that the world has, a solution for sin. Because she is a sinner, an adulterer. And that separates her from a holy God. And because of that sin, she cannot be in a right relationship with God. That can only take place through salvation offered freely by Jesus Christ. And so Jesus confronts her sin in a very direct way, cutting right to the heart of the matter. This woman is being brought to face the guilt and shame of sin. And note this in the text, that she doesn't spill the beans herself, right? She doesn't admit the sin really herself. She kind of gives an answer that is true-ish. You know, it's like true-ish. It's like a kid being caught for not cleaning their room, right? Did you clean your room? Yes, I cleaned my room. Then the parent goes up and sees that the room isn't really clean. And they're like, well, I picked up a couple of things off the floor, right? I cleaned some of the room. That's kind of like what's happening here. She doesn't really admit what's going on. It's true that she has no husband, but there is a lot more to that story than just that. And so Jesus just says it. Jesus, being all-knowing, just says it. He says, you're right, you have no husband. You've had five husbands, and the one that you have now is not your husband. The man you're living with now is not your husband. This changes everything. Do you see the shift in her perspective in the text? Look at verse 19. And the woman said to him, sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. This changes everything. Jesus had just told her whole history, even though this is the first time they've ever met, and this changes everything. She now sees him as a prophet. It's like this blindfold is coming off of her eyes, where before she was blinded by sin. The only thing that she could see was her sin. She couldn't see anything else. She couldn't see the spiritual truth that Jesus was telling her about the living water and how she would never have to thirst again, that Jesus is the source of her refreshment. She couldn't see it because her sin was blinding her. It was keeping her from seeing it. She was being guided around. This is the only thing that I can see. I can't see anything going forward. And this makes me walk into dangerous places when I can't see where I'm going forward. Thank you. Dangerous places. Am I near the edge right now? Okay. Did someone say no? Okay. I don't know what to... Now I don't know where I'm at. But then Jesus tells her sin, just lays it out right in front of her, confronts her with it, brings it to her, and she sees it. She's aware of it. The guilt and the shame of sin is apparent now. And all of a sudden, she kind of removes the blindfold. She's like, wait, what is going on here? Who is this man? He's told me all that I've ever done. Who is this man? This is different than anything I've ever experienced. This must be a prophet to be able to tell me everything that I've done, all of my sin. This is the start. My awareness of sin is the start. She started off thinking, this is just a pretty, wow, this is an interesting Jewish guy to talk to me. But now she knows that he is much more than that. After he unveiled her sin, she calls him a prophet. And that means one who speaks for God. One who speaks for God. And so I think a natural question to this is, where are you in this process? Where are you at? Are you still blind, walking around in your sin, without a care, ignorant of the things that are going on around you, ignorant of the spiritual truth? Or maybe you are aware of your sin, but you're indifferent towards it. You're not interested in doing anything about it. You've accepted it, and that's the way you want to live your life. Or three, are you like this woman? Are you aware of your sin and also aware of your need to make it right with God? We're going to see that from her right here in the next point, which is my worship of God is the response. My worship of God is the response. Look at verse 20 with me. Our fathers worshiped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship. I love this question in response to what had just happened. She knows he speaks for God. She's feeling conviction, and she wants more. She wants to worship. She is aware of her sin, and she knows that she needs to make it right with God. So she asks, where do I go? I know what I need to go. I know what I need to do, but where do I go? Where do I go to worship God? I need to go there right now. You see, it's confusing to her because the Samaritans built a temple on the mountain, and that's where they worshiped. But the Jewish people say that you need to worship in Jerusalem. And a Jewish man just told her her whole history of sin. So maybe, is that where I need to go and worship? Do I need to go to the priest there and make an offering? Do I need to go worship in the temple in Jerusalem? She just wants to worship God, and she's wondering where. Where do I do it? At the mountain in Jerusalem? And Jesus says something very profound here that's true for us today. Verse 21, Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me. Trust what I have to say. Believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews." This is a prophecy that Jesus is saying right here. It's a prophecy of what's to come in the not so distant future. You see, in just a couple of decades, in 70 AD, the Romans will come in and they will destroy the temple in Jerusalem so completely that not one stone was left upon another. The place of worship in Jerusalem was destroyed. And historical accounts tell us that then the Romans went up to Mount Gerizim, which is where the Samaritans worshiped, and they slaughtered thousands of Samaritans, ending the worship there as well. There was no place left to worship. This is a prophecy from Jesus that will come to pass in 70 AD. You're not going to worship on this mountain. And you're not going to worship in Jerusalem because those places are going to be destroyed utterly. There's no place left to worship. And this is the point that Jesus is making. True worship doesn't demand a place. It doesn't demand a building. It doesn't demand a location or a ceremony or a service or a ritual. It demands a heart that loves God, honors God, exalts God, obeys God, and serves God. True worship does not demand a place. It doesn't demand a mountain. It doesn't demand a temple. It doesn't demand a location or a ceremony or a ritual. It demands a heart that loves God. And you see an amazing thing. At the death of Jesus Christ, something incredible happened. The veil was torn. The veil which hung between the holy place and the holy of holies was torn, ripped apart from top to bottom. That symbolized the end of Old Testament religious worship. Ripping the barrier between the holiest, holy of holies and the holy place. Ripping that apart ended the Old Testament religious worship. No more mountains, no more temples, no more priests, no more altars for sacrifice, no more. Now, every place is a place of worship. Now every believer is part of the priesthood. Isn't that incredible? Every place, because of Jesus' death on the cross, the tearing of the veil, every place is a place of worship. Every place that you go is a place of worship. And every believer is a priest. That's awesome. Then he offers a quick, just a little critique, just a really fast critique of the Samaritan religion, saying, you guys don't even know what you're worshiping. You worship what you do not know. You don't even know what you're worshiping. At least the Jewish people have the truth. At least the Jewish people have the scriptures, the truth of God, that the Messiah will come through their lineage. That's what he means when he says that salvation is from the Jews. Just a small critique. He's defining this idea of worship for her. He continues in verse 23, but the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. This is the type of worshiper that God wants. True worshipers, not external religious people. He wants true worshipers, internal, real, genuine, true worshipers. And those worshipers, the scripture says, worship God in spirit and truth. Now, maybe you've heard that phrase a couple of times. Hands up if you've heard, we worship God in spirit and truth, right? You might have heard it a lot, a couple of times. But what does that mean? Maybe you don't know what that means. What does spirit and truth mean? Well, let me give you a very, very simple answer to that question. What does spirit and truth mean? Here's a very simple answer. Your heart and your head. Your emotions and your thought. Your heart and your mind. Spirit and truth. And note, it's spirit and truth. It's not spirit or truth. It's spirit and truth. It's both of them happening at the same time, like two sides of a coin. They go together. They're not separate. They go together. It's like peanut butter and jelly, right? Delicious. I have some right here. These things go together, right? You cannot separate them. I mean, you can, but it's terrible, okay? Like, seriously, jelly by itself? Like, what? Who would eat this by itself? Like a crazy person, maybe. Like, who's eating jelly? No one. And I know that there are probably a few of you right now who are like, but Pastor Tommy, you don't understand. Peanut butter by itself, pretty good. First off, you're wrong. And second, you probably also like pineapple on your pizza. So I don't really know. I don't really know what we can discuss after that, you know? I just don't, I don't have it. These two things go together. You can't separate them. You cannot. When you do, it just isn't right. It's just not right. The same thing with spirit and truth. You can separate them, but it's not right. They go together. I think John Piper says it well. I think we have a quote that'll come up on the screen. I think he says it well. He says this, "Worship must be vital and real in the heart, and worship must rest on a true perception of God. There must be spirit and there must be truth. Truth without emotion produces dead orthodoxy and a church full or half full of artificial admirers. On the other hand, emotion without truth produces empty frenzy and cultivates shallow people who refuse the discipline of rigorous thought. But true worship comes from people who are deeply emotional and who love deep and sound doctrine. Strong affections for God, rooted in truth, are the bone and marrow of biblical worship. Spirit and truth. Deep emotion and rigorous truth about God. This is the type of worship that God is looking for. Spirit and truth." And so then the woman says to him in verse 25, "I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. And when he comes, he will tell us all things." And then this, Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am he." That's a pretty big bomb that just got dropped. Like, there's no mystery here. There's no second guessing. Jesus just comes out and says it. "I am the Messiah. I am he who is speaking to you." This is a pretty big statement. If you read through the gospel, practically never does this appear to a Jewish person ever in the gospel, where Jesus just flat out says, "I'm the Messiah." But here it happens to this Samaritan woman. He just says to her, "I am he. I am the Messiah." That's pretty incredible. That's pretty incredible. So if spirit and truth is about the internal, the heart and the mind, and not the external, what does that mean? What does that mean? What does that mean for us? Well, it means this. It means that it's not about the building. It's not about the building where you worship. It's not about this building where we worship. It's not about how many people are in attendance. Those are external things. It's not about how good the music is. That's an external thing. It's not about how gifted the preacher is, thank God. That's an external thing. It's not about the lights. And it's not about what the people around me are doing. They're taking vigorous notes or flipping through Instagram. Doesn't matter. It's all about what I'm doing with my heart and my mind toward God. Spirit and truth. None of the external should affect that at all. That's the worshiper that God is looking for. Someone who worships in spirit and truth. And then here's the last thing that we're going to see in the passage, and we're going to go a little bit quicker through this one, is my witness for God is the result. My witness for God is the result. Starting in verse 27, Just then, his disciples came back, and they marveled that he was talking with a woman. This is a strange thing. But no one said, "What do you seek?" or "Why are you talking with her?" So the woman left her jar and went away into town and said to the people, "Come, see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ?" They went out of the town and were coming to him. Here is the result. This is the result of this woman's encounter with the source of refreshment of her soul, coming to the understanding of her sin, being taught true worship by Jesus. This is the result. She immediately runs into town and tells everyone that she can about Jesus. Tells everyone. "You need to come and see this." And you can tell it's immediate because she left her water jar there. The very thing that she came out to collect, she left. She's like, "I gotta go back. I gotta tell these people." This is the result of an encounter with Christ. You tell people about him. Also note that she doesn't go into town speaking a bunch of theological truths, right? She doesn't do that. She just tells them about her personal story of encountering Jesus Christ. "Come and see. Come and see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ?" She just shared her personal testimony with the people. And this is the power of a personal testimony. It gets people intrigued about Jesus. They're saying, "Wow, no way, really? He told you everything that you ever did? I have to see this for myself. Where's this Jesus?" Right? And the people then start coming out of town. They were coming to Jesus. Goes on, verse 31. "Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, saying, 'Rabbi, eat.' But he said to them, 'I have food to eat that you do not know about.' So the disciples said to one another, 'Has anyone brought him something to eat?' And Jesus said to him, 'My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work.'" I love this. Again, Jesus is taking the physical need, this time of hunger and food, and he is making a metaphor for spiritual desire. Jesus was focused only on doing the will of the Father who sent him and to accomplish his works. And what is the will of the Father? And what are the works of the Father that need to be accomplished? Simple. Salvation. Redemption. God's work in human history is that of redemption. Redeeming the sinner. Redeeming the lost. He is the Redeemer. He is the Savior. Later in this chapter, it's going to call him the Savior of the world. He's the Redeemer, the Savior. And he delights in that work. Then he goes on in verse 35. "Do not say there are yet 4 months, then comes the harvest. Look, I tell you, lift up your eyes and see that the fields are white for harvest. Already the one who reaps is receiving wages and gathering fruit for eternal life, so that the sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap for that which you did not labor. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labor." This is a prophecy for what is about to happen in the next coming minutes here to the disciples. He's saying, look, the harvest isn't 4 months away. It's right now. It's right this second. The fields are white for harvest. And no, he's not talking about the grain as he looks across the field to the town of Sychar. He's not seeing white heads on these grain stalks signifying that it's ready for the harvest. That's not what he's seeing. That's not what he's saying. He is saying, look, he's talking about the Samaritans. They're walking out to him through the field in their traditional white robes. And he's saying, look, the field is white for harvest. It's ripe. It's ready. It's happening right now. And the disciples were about to reap the harvest. Jesus is telling them, these people are going to be saved. These people are going to be saved. And you are going to get the joy of receiving the wage of reaping that right now. So not only is Jesus prophesying right here, but he's also sharing a very practical teaching about evangelism. It's very practical. He's teaching the disciples that sometimes you will sow the seeds and sometimes you will reap the seeds. That's the truth of evangelism, isn't it? Sometimes you are sowing the seed and sometimes you are reaping them. So can I just tell you, don't be discouraged. Don't be discouraged when a conversation with Jesus, about Jesus Christ, doesn't result in the other person's immediate salvation. We can get so bogged down here, can't we? We can have that conversation, we can feel so good, and they don't come to know Jesus And all of a sudden you're like, man, I'm discouraged by that. I put myself out there to evangelize and seemingly nothing happened. First off, let me tell you, that's not true. You've sown the seeds of salvation into their heart. The rest is up to God. You know, I went to coffee this week. I went to a coffee shop this week in the morning, and I put a little sign on the table as I was drinking my coffee and working on this sermon. And the sign said, it was just a small little sign, a folded piece of paper in half. The sign said, do you have a question about Jesus Christ? Come ask me. And I went about my morning drinking delicious coffee and working on this sermon. I had exactly 4 people stop by in 2 hours, roughly. 2 of them were already Christians, of course, right? They wanted to come and talk about Jesus. It was awesome. And the other 2 had genuine questions. I answered all the questions that they had, hopefully as well as I could. I shared the gospel with them. And let me tell you, neither of them accepted Jesus that day. Neither of them did. But I'm not discouraged. I'm not discouraged by that. I'll be back there this week doing the same thing, sitting in the same spot with the same sign, because I know that I have planted the seed in those 2 people. The seed of salvation is in them. And I would love the opportunity to do that again to someone else. I plant it so that someone else may water. But the truth is that God gives the growth. He gives the growth. And so my job and our job is to just share the gospel faithfully. The resulting salvation, well, that's God's job. And don't get me wrong, it's great when I get to be the one who reaps and the person comes to salvation right then and there. That's awesome. But I'm just as happy to sow the seed. And you should be too. Stop thinking that it's all up to you. It isn't. It's up to God. And when we start thinking like that, it takes the pressure off of evangelism a lot for us, doesn't it? Now to end the verse for us in verse 39. This is awesome. Many Samaritans from the town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me all that I ever did. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days, and many more believed because of his word. And they said to the woman, it is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is indeed, here it is, the Savior of the world. This woman at the well got to be a part of both sides of evangelism in a short amount of time. She was able to sow the seeds by sharing her testimony of her personal encounter with Christ. And then coming to faith later, verse 42, you can see it. They said, it's no longer because of what you said that we believe, but because we heard for ourselves from Jesus. She sowed those seeds. But she also got to reap with many believing because of her testimony right away. Look at verse 39. Many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. She got to experience both sides of that. This whole town got rocked by the gospel because of the faith of this woman and her witness after meeting the Savior of the world. And all of this because Jesus refreshed the deepest longings of her soul. She went out and she shared that refreshment with others. So let me ask you a simple question. Have you been refreshed by Jesus? Has he refreshed the deepest longings of your soul? Well, if he has, then go and share in faith like this Samaritan woman did so well and so beautifully. Amen? Let's pray. God, we thank you for our time together. We thank you for the truth of your word, the story of faith of the Samaritan woman and how you, Lord, you encountered her in a special and unique way, Lord. She came to face with the source of her refreshment for her soul. She was made aware of her sin. Worship was her response, and witness was the result. Lord, would that be true of us who have had an encounter with you? Not only, Lord, would we come to you to be refreshed, because you are the only place that we can come and be refreshed, but would we because of that refreshment, because of that deep satisfying that is happening in our soul, would we not keep that for ourselves? Would we go out just like this woman in faith and share it with others? Would the city of Elgin, would the city of Carpentersville, West Dundee, Gilberts, Pingree Grove, South Elgin, St. Charles, Lord, all of the surrounding Fox Valley, would it be just like this town of Sekar, where many people from our cities believed in him because of the testimony of these people, because of you, Lord? Would you help us to share that? And would we trust you for the result, Lord? Help us do that this week. Help us do that this month, this year, Lord. Help that to become a regular part of who we are and what we do. We pray in the strong name of Jesus. Amen.